praise God together with all our might. You rejoice over us with singing. You rejoice over us. Thank you, Lord, that you love us so much. You rejoice, rejoice, rejoice over us. Hallelujah! Avenge and defend us, deliver, save and help, preserve and rescue. You rejoice over us with joy, a violent emotion to us, rejoicing over us, O Lord, with joyful You are mighty in our midst. You free, avenge, and defend us. Deliver, save, and help. Preserve and rescue. You rejoice over us with joy, with violent emotion twirl. Rejoicing over us, O Lord, with joyful shouts. With joyful shouts. Valiant. cheerfully rejoice. Our hearts embraced by thoughts of a future and of hope, settled and secure.
Thank you.
called out of the darkness into his glorious light, in exceeding gladness and cheerfulness of heart. The body of Christ breaks forth in praise, breaks forth in praise. Zephaniah 3:17 says that the Lord dances and spins violently, full of emotion over us. He sings over us. He sings for joy because of us. When we were yet in sin, you loved us first. Like David, we say, Lord, we love to praise your holy name. Every tongue that's raised, you will condemn. This is our inheritance, and our righteousness is from God. Thank you. seated with him in heavenly places, far above powers and principalities. Know your authority in Christ, that you are seated with him in heavenly places, because we have come to Mount Zion, the heavenly Jerusalem, the city of God, the church of the firstborn registered in heaven. To God the judge of all, to Jesus the mediator of a better covenant, better covenant, and we are there, we are there, we have come, we are already there, through Christ our Lord, our Savior, we have entered the Holy of Holy. Hallelujah, we are there. We have come to Mount Zion. Praise you, you've answered us and have become our salvation.
God, it's wonderful to believe that. It was a revelation that the church existed before the world was created. That it was in the Simonstown Summit where we had that revelation, the eternal church and the eternal gospel, and that we actually linked with them, because Hebrews 12 says, you have come, not you're going to come. And my whole life I've been trying to get there. That verse says, you have already come by worship, by singing in spirit and truth, learning to preach accurately and believe accurately. He says, you have already come. You're there. We linked with the most perfect church. We're not perfect yet. We're being perfected. But we linked with something eternal. It's a wonderful revelation. Thank you, Lee, Pastor Lee, for leading us with his new guitar. It's a new addition to the family. Praise God, and turn around, give someone a hug, tell them God loves them. They've forgotten it by now. Thank you.
You know, you and Dale should really now make a CD.
This morning, we announced that they now want, our plans have been for the church building have been approved in principle, but now they want a security fence with two security gates all around the whole property, which is rather big. And they ask $210,000 just for the fence. We've secured the builders that will build the church for us for $2.5 million that's been given to us, donated by an anonymous giver. So we thank God for that. But now we have to pay for the fence before they will finally scrutinize the plans. And we also have to announce our landscaping and things like that before they'll let it go so we can start building. The builders are ready. We've been waiting 6 months for this. Now we know what the snag was. They want the fence. They could have told us that a few months ago, I think. But we have to raise $210,000, which is not part of the building fee. It's contingency fees. So this morning, by promissory notes, we raised $75,000 for that. So we still need $125,000. So we trust God for that, because the moment we can pay for the fence, we can start building. That's what I understand. And, you know, we don't want the builders to start building another project. Then when we're finally ready, they say, no, we're busy with something else, and their price goes up. And so let's trust God that as soon as possible, you know, we said 42 people can give 5,000 rand each. It's 210,000. And then after that, you know, we'll have to raise funds for the brick paving and the gardening and whatever. I don't know all the contingency things. But let's trust God we can do it together. And if anyone watching live streaming wants to contribute financially towards the building of our church in Burgundy Estates, then you can go on the website and click on the button that says financial contribution, and that'll give you all the banking details. So we trust God that He will speak to people, and each one of us will do our share so we can start building. So we need another 125,000. We trust God. If any of you would like to contribute towards that, do we still have some of those notes? Ushers, we can hand them out and give it to some people. Anyone that wasn't here this morning, you would like to have a promissory note to fill in, you can give it back to us so we know where we stand. And then we know what else to pray for and trust God for. Thank you very much. And we want to take up the normal tithes and offerings. You give as God has prospered you. Thank you for your faithfulness in that. And anyone on this side need any? Okay. Thank you. All right. Any testimonies tonight? I want to thank God. You know, in our first or second year of ministry, no, it was when we came back from Australia, about 5 years in the ministry, as I prayed for people in the healing line, a man jumped forward and tried to strangle me. And he screamed out loud. He was demon-possessed. But he couldn't get his hands on my neck. It was very fearful, because he's screaming and he's shaking and he's trying to strangle me, but there was something stopping his hands. I think it's an angel's hand or somebody. I was so scared. I just stood there and said, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. And do you know, everyone just suddenly started praying in tongues. It's amazing. Nobody attacked him to get him off me. They all just like, karabasarabasa. I thought, get him off me. It's not time to pray in tongues now. And then all of a sudden, I kept saying, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. And then he fell backwards underneath ended up under the third row of chairs. Like he was pushed like that on the carpet. And he lay there, wriggling and screaming. Then suddenly, he went limp. Now I went towards him and he looked up and he said, where am I? I said, you're in church. He says, how do I get there? How did I get there? I said, I don't know. First time I've seen you, he wanted to kill me. And he was sent there by Satan. Then he shared with us that he was a Springbok karate expert that went to Japan to study under a master. And he says there a murderous spirit entered him. And he had that in him, but he didn't know how he got to church. Never been there before. And tried to kill me, but God protected. So then he started weeping, and he was so happy. He jumped up, strong guy. And he grabbed me and squeezed me. And he broke my midrib bone. I never know what it's called. Sternum. He broke my sternum. You just heard it crack. And from then on, I had tremendous pain. And this, the bottom part, you know, the where they come together, there's a little link there. That thing stood out like this, like that, all my life. So I was always scared to wear a jersey. Monte Stansu 8. And if I sit long, like at the piano there, I have to push the... It's, the bone there is like cartilage bone. And when I sit or sleep, they can't leave a skiff, and I have to push them back my whole life. But I had pains for a long time. And I asked the Lord about that. He says, it's part of your scars for the ministry. And I said, yeah, but it's not lekker. You know, and then God took away the pain, but this thing still stuck out like that. And sometimes that was still sore. If I do, you know, I sit in a certain position or drive, it's sore. And when Hilton and I were in Palawan, the island of Palawan, that conference we had there, the one night I was so sore. I said, Hilton, come pray for me. And he laid his hand, prayed, and you know what? The bone's gone back. Look there, it's normal. It's a great miracle. I'm talking from 1986. It's now 2016. How many years? 30 years I've waited for this miracle. It's done now. Because doctors can't do that. They, you see, this isn't bone that can heal. It's cartilage. You hurt your wrist, it's sore forever. But bone, you can restructure and mend, and it's fine, stronger than before. So I thank God. Pain is gone. I still have to squeeze it in position now and again, but this thing doesn't stick out like that anymore. It doesn't look at me anymore. Keda. That's the button you see there. Yeah. Isn't that wonderful? Yeah, I want to thank the Lord for that publicly, because, you know, now I can sleep on my stomach. I couldn't sleep on my stomach for 30 years if I want to. I don't like sleeping on my stomach. But if I want to, I can. I don't puncture the mattress anymore. Yeah. Any other testimonies? Where? There we are. Okay.
Good evening, church. I just want to testify... I just want to testify, a few weeks ago, I found myself in a situation where somebody just walked in front of me and just opened up a knife and immediately demanded some stuff from me, like my phone and my wallet. And at that moment, it's almost like God's calmness just came over me. I first wanted to run from the guy, because then I realized, but this guy is much, much faster than me. He's going to run me in and somehow stabbed me from the back. And as I stand there, I said, I don't want to give my phone, I don't want to give my wallet, but almost like the Holy Spirit just make me calm, and I immediately give my phone and my wallet and everything. And as he took everything and just immediately walked away, I just immediately asked the Holy Spirit to start forgiving this person. Because, I mean, obviously he took something from you which you've worked for, and you, I mean, it's like, it's a terrible feeling. In the Monday morning, I got to work. I said to God, I need a phone because obviously for work purposes, and I mean, my life is in danger. I walked everywhere. I used public transport. And today I can testify that God blessed me with a new phone. God blessed me with a car. And I mean, I could just praise God. I mean, somehow God just intervened in this whole situation. And really, the moment I asked God to that I could forgive him, I mean, the peace of God could flood into my life, and God's blessings could flow into my life. So I just want to give glory and honor to God. Amen.
If you filled in a form, you can just give it back to one of the ushers, and I can give it to Billy. Thank you. So we can know what was given tonight. We can rejoice together, trusting God. It's, you know, it's more than we can afford, but it's God working in and through us, and he'll bless us for erecting a structure there where people can worship God even after we're gone. Amen. Praise God. All right. Yes. Isaiah 55. Verse 2. Well, let's read verse 1. Ho, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters, and you have no money, come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk. Eben van Wijk, Pastor Mornay and Adele's son, he had a dream about me, that I was giving people things to eat, food to eat, and milk. And I made a note of it here in my Bible. Come buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend money for what is not bread, and your wages for what does not satisfy? Listen diligently to me, and eat what is good, and let your soul delight itself in abundance. Incline your ear, come to me, hear, and your soul shall live. I'll make an everlasting covenant with you, one that cannot be broken, the sure mercies of David. In other words, God will have mercy on him. For sure. He doesn't have to doubt that. Indeed, I've given him as a witness to the people, a leader and a commander for the people. And then the verse that took us to Australia, surely you shall call a nation you do not know, and nations who do not know you shall run to you. That verse is fulfilled in our lives because of the Lord your God and the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. He's endowed you with a certain splendor that draws people. Wonderful portion of scripture. Wonderful portion of scripture. All right. I want to share on the simple statement that Jesus alone can satisfy your soul. Jesus satisfies your soul. And he says, why do you labor for that which does not satisfy? Why do you labor for that which does not satisfy? Now, I made a list of a few verses where the word satisfy occurs. And briefly, Psalm 91, verse 16, with long life will I satisfy you. Psalm 103, verse 5, he satisfies your mouth with good things. Psalm 105, verse 40, he satisfied them with bread from heaven, bread of heaven. Psalm 107, verse 9, he satisfies the longing soul. Psalm 132, verse 15, he will abundantly bless you and satisfy you. Psalm 145, verse 16, he satisfies the desire of his people. To satisfy means to fill up, to satiate or to make complete, to feed, to water. Jeremiah 31, verse 12 says, you shall be like a watered garden, raveh in Hebrew, R-A-V-E-H. You will be full and satiated. Amen. So he says, don't labor for food which perishes, but for the food which endures, which the Son of Man will give you. John 6, verse 27, Jesus repeated it. Because God the Father has set his seal on him. John 6, verse 55, my flesh is food indeed. My blood is drink indeed. I am the bread which came down from heaven. I am the manna. And then to illustrate that, he broke the bread and fed 5,000 men. A little boy's lunch. Five loaves and two fish he broke. I once preached on that in Soshanguve outside Pretoria in our tent campaign. And I took a loaf of bread with me, one loaf. And so I said to people, come, take a piece. And each one took whatever he wanted to. I didn't break it. I said, come and take it. And you know, then afterwards, I said, okay, now hold up your piece. How many people took? 142 from one loaf. You know, and I thought, well, still got a few thousand to go, but it's a good start. It's a good start. So, Jesus, John chapter 4, verse 32, 34, he said to his disciples, I have food to eat that you don't know of. My food, or the thing that sustains me, is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. Finish his work. It's good and it's advisable to eat the right foods. And if you know what agrees with your blood type or your system, it's good to know all that and to eat accordingly and not just eat wrong things that do your body harm, because each person is different. It's very difficult to follow a diet that's set like that's the only diet in the world, because it doesn't agree with everybody. So it's good to be disciplined in what you eat. I really need Vors and Pop. That's what I need. It's very good for my system. That's why I eat it. Right? So you must know what agrees with you. Snook and Patats agrees with me. Vegetables. Yeah, I eat it as much as I can, then I cover it with a squash. So Nola can't see, but She's become wise over the years. She lifts up the squash. Ek eet eers die squashie leeg, dan skuif ek al die groente so in die hoek, sit ek squashie oor. That's very, don't you think it's a good technique? Yeah, I taught it to Hilton too. So she sees two empty plates with two squashies, upturned, omgedraaide, omgekeerde squashies. And, but you know, anyway, we do eat our vegetables. Met lang tanden. Maar it's good for you, vegetables. And fruit's good for you. Vegetables, fruit are cheap. Except if you buy at Woolworths. But everywhere else, it's very cheap. Their prices just keep going up. And you know what? There's less in the packets. It's a fact. You should write to them. Tell your pastor says. Yeah. Anyway. But we're starting to grow our own things now. Our own little herb garden. We've started growing some veggies. I know Lee and them had a vegetable patch. But our tortoise thinks we're growing it for him. Our tortoise is 18 years old. His name is Gandhi. I fed him carrots yesterday. Jeez, I eat them. It's like a coin, but he thought Nola grew the herb garden just for him. And then Nola went and spoke to him, said, "This nie vir jou nie." At great speed. Yeah, he walks. He tries to walk fast, but it's slow, man. Do you know how the tortoise beat the hare in the race? He said to the hare, "Watch me." Very clever. You must be clever if you're not fast. But anyway, and growing some fruit and things. You know, we're lazy to grow things, and each piece of ground can produce something. We have so many guavas, ek kan nie voorblij nie, ek gedog, ek moet hulle allemaal opeet die eerste paar maanden, maar toe kon ek nie meer eet nie, nou gee ons het weg. It keeps on just producing grenadillas. You, what did I say, guavas? My mom had a guava tree, yeah, in Milnerton, that produced the whole year. This amazing tree. Every afternoon I come from school, go to the fridge, drink as much guava juice as I want. Lekker. Then I had to take it to all the neighbors once a week. Wat ek vir die neighbors. And the old Jewish lady appreciated that very much and let me use her swimming pool. Yeah, that was wonderful. Take a guava juice, already have my costume on. Yeah, and I still love guava juice, it's wonderful, but you know, it's good to know what to eat and what suits your body, but the main thing is, Jesus said there's something that will sustain your life that's better than any diet, and that is to do the will of the Father and to finish his work. You know what the will of the Father is for you. When you do that, it's better than following a strict diet. It will sustain. He says, that sustains me. The thing that sustains me, my meat or my food or the thing that sustains me is doing my Father's will. You're doing your Father's will by being in church tonight, right? Well, that's what will sustain you this week. Little things. Doing your Father's will and finishing it. I know because I go to nations to preach and to teach the make disciples. That's doing his will. I'm trying to finish his work. We all share in it together. So that's what sustains you. Jesus went to Samaria and preached to that woman at the well. That was his Father's will. Because you read there, John chapter 4, verse 1, that Jesus needed to go, had to go, was led to go. The Greek word is deo, means he was almost forced to go to Samaria from Jerusalem. His Father said, you must go to Samaria. And there that woman got saved, she believed in him, and she brought the whole town, and the whole town believed in him. Okay? I've just finished rewriting my diary from Australia, because I've never wanted to rewrite it all my life because of all the hardships we had there. But now that Hilton went there, I had the courage to rewrite it. So I did it the last few months, and it's finished now. And hope to publish it sooner or later. It's called Fair Dinkum Aussie Mission. And, God sent us there. God sent us there. When God leads you and guides you, when you do His will, it strengthens you, it sustains you, makes you last a bit longer, makes you stronger. It's spiritual food. Amen? And so, Hebrews 5, verse 13 and 14 says, solid food or sustained foods that will sustain you, or meat that Jesus referred to, belongs to those who are mature, who, having exercised their gifts, discerning evil and good, but milk belongs to babies. The milk of the word. You grow thereby, but then you must progress from milk to meat, isn't it? Baby uses milk, but then you must learn how to chew. It'd be terrible if all you got now at your ripe old age is just milk every day. Eh? You'd look terrible. Eh? You need meat. So it says solid food belongs to those who've exercised their spiritual senses. You need to learn to exercise the gifts that God has given you. Develop them so that you can become mature, so that you can discern. Most people can't discern. They don't know what's going on. You have to discern by the Holy Spirit. You must exercise your cooperation. When I was young, I found out that there is something like a word of knowledge, and I wanted that. That's the one I wanted. I said to God, please give me a word of knowledge. And so I'd stand in the bank, and the queues. And then I'd look at the person in front of me, and I'd say, God, give me a word about this person. And one day I stood behind a guy who was very badly dressed. And I thought I was, reasonably neat. So I looked, I said, God, give me a word. He says, Holy Spirit immediately said to me, he's got his own business. I thought, this guy. It was my reaction. I didn't tell the Holy Spirit, but that's what I thought. He knows now because I've told you now. So. You know how when God speaks to you, how you think differently, your mind, it's altijd skif. It's always at enmity with the Spirit. No, do this. Let someone else do it. The mind just never grows up. You have to renew it. And so, then I tapped the guy on the shoulder. He turned around. Yes. I said, what do you do? He says, I've got my own business. Okay, good, thank you. And I walked into the, I told you this before, but I walked into the stationery shop just around the corner from the bank, Standard Bank there in Alberton, stationery shop. I wanted to buy a few things. And there was a girl that worked there, blonde, long red nails, red lips, false eyelashes. They wear those things to chase away the flies, you know? She flee kom maak en net so nou sê. Yeah. And she was on the phone. And I just got the things I wanted and I stood at the counter waiting for her to finish her phone call. And the Holy Spirit said to me, the man she's speaking to is not her wife. It's not her husband. It's not her husband. I thought, it's got nothing to do with me. I don't know what my to do. Say, come on, pardon me, we say, well, I can net die goed koop. And the Holy Spirit said to me again, the man she's speaking to is not her husband. I said, so? I have to know that. Three times he said to me. So then I realized, you know, when God keeps saying something to you, it's because you don't quite understand what he wants you to do. Then he repeats it. The same thing. And so the third time, you're giving me a word of knowledge. Yes, you asked for words of knowledge. Now what must I do with it? You must tell her. And what's she going to do? He didn't answer me. So she puts the phone down and comes around the counter. Can I help you? I said, was that your husband on the phone? No. Why do you want to know? How do you know? The Holy Spirit told me. So what? The Holy Spirit told me. What? The Holy Spirit told me. Great man of faith struggling to. She says, and what else did he tell you? But he didn't tell me anything else. Now I'm on my back foot. I go, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, what else did you tell me? Holy Spirit. She says, come on, come on. You say he speaks to you. Come on. What else? Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, quickly, quickly, quickly. And he says to me, she's a backslidden Pentecostal girl. And the people she's going around with are keeping her away from God. By this time, there's no other people in the shop, in the queue. And the two of us, Han Anya. So I say, you're a backslidden Pentecostal girl. And the people you hang around with are keeping you away from God. And you know what? She collapsed on the counter. Like this. And she started crying. Yeah, more or less like that. I know. I'm just trying to give you the picture. I can't cry like a girl because I'm a boy, you know. So they cry much higher. No, I can. Yeah. And those days, they didn't have waterproof makeup. And haar oë was swart, boetie. So sy nag. And And when she looked up, I got such a fright. I stepped on the person behind me. Because she's... It's like... She looked like one of the members of the band Kiss, you know. It's like... So I asked her, I said... I didn't laugh. I'm laughing now, but then I didn't laugh. I was quite serious, and all the people were like, "Krik klaar," you know, "Mak klaar," you know, "Hitching," and he said, "Ah, futsak." No, I didn't say futsak, but the reactions. And then I asked her, "Do you want to come back to the Lord?" And she said, "Yes." So I prayed for her there on the count. I said, "Pray after me, say, Father, forgive my sins, cleanse me from all unrighteousness, lead me back to the Lord. I will serve you. I'll break away from the friends that keep me from you." So, you know, then I bought the station and I left. 17 years later, Nola and I speak at a business person's. You know, you mustn't say businessmen anymore. A business person, because it could be male or female or child, you don't know, or an opa. And we're at a business person's breakfast in Boksburg. You know where Boksburg is? In the East Rand, all the towns are with a B. Boksburg, Benoni, Brakpan. In Boksburg, and they're announcing things, we're eating breakfast. It's full, the hall's full, little tables. And I look around, I say, "Nola, that woman was the lady in the stationery shop." She says, "How do you know?" I said, "I know." So I went up to her. I said, "Excuse me, did you work in a stationery shop 17 years ago in Alberton?" She says, "Yes. Who are you?" I said, "I'm the man that led you back to God." She says, "You know what? I cried so much I couldn't see who it was and I can't remember who it was. And all this time I've asked God, I want to meet that person again to say thank you." She says, "I am now an agent for Christian artists. I'm arranging for them to sing in churches and at conferences, and I'm doing it full time, and I'm training people, you know, how to behave on stage." And he's got a business helping young singers. So we met up again after. I said, "And what did you do after that?" She says, "I broke away from, you know, people I was living with and started serving God in a church, and I haven't stopped since then. Thank you for coming into the shop." I said, "Yes, but you looked horrible." No, I didn't. No, I didn't. Because, you know, she's pretty, but the makeup was flooding all over the face. So, you know, a word of knowledge God gave me that. I started exercising my spiritual gifts that I wanted. I asked God for one and then he'd give it, but then you must exercise them and grow in your understanding of how it works and to use your faith. You cannot just live by your reason. You have to start living by faith. You have to learn how it works. Otherwise, you'll stay immature. He says it's for mature people. Those who exercise their spiritual senses. Pray in tongues. And ask God now and again for the interpretation. Learn to prophesy, to edify others. This is not your nation, but you've been sent here. And because you've been sent here and calling a nation that you don't know, that verse applies to you. It says, God has glorified you, and many nations will run to you. You will minister to other nations as well. because you're willing to give up your homeland to serve people here. Wow, it is doing God's will. And you know what? That's the thing that sustains you, that makes you wake up in the morning and feel life is worth living. It's not easy what you're doing. But God bless you. Thank you. We need all the help we can get in this country. And thank God for people who obey God. God bless you. Amen. And he says that I am the Lord your God that has glorified you. There's glory on you, my brother. And that's what draws people to you. That's what opens doors for you. And, you know, meditate on that scripture there. Because the previous one says that he made him a leader and a commander of the people. So there's leadership abilities in you that when you recognize them, you'll be able to command people. Say, do this, do that for God, for the kingdom of God. And same with you. You're also from somewhere else?
Yeah, I'm
his daughter. Okay. Well, the same applies for you. It's not everyone that would do that. But those scriptures, I mean, I picked this sermon to preach tonight. I didn't know you would be here, but it applies. Amen? So meditate on that, and may the Holy Spirit give you. And so exercise your spiritual senses, not just your natural senses. You see, your natural senses, you taste, you smell, you hear, you see, and you feel. Those are your senses. Now, spiritually, you see, your spirit body is the same as your physical body. Your spiritual body can hear, can see into the spirit realm, can hear in the spirit. But if you don't exercise it, you remain ignorant. So I say, it's my definition, your spiritual ear is the desire to hear. And your spiritual eye, therefore, is what? Your desire to see, to discern things. And so ask God. You know, it doesn't mean you want to see demons around every corner. It means you want to see things. You know, that's how you see signs. You know, the world put up signs that make you wonder. But God gives you signs and wonders. Which one do you want? Eh? Yeah, in Cape Town, the road signs are so bad. It's signs, but they make you wonder if you must turn left now or later. And many times the sign is after the turn off. As you klaar verby en nog, you passed. You've got to mark a kaapse draai before you come back. Signs that make you wonder. No, God gives you signs and wonders. You know, the Big Ben painting that I painted. So I must now set the arms. And I thought, you know, let's balance it. So I put 11:15. Looks like nice balance. I'm falling in. And so I painted that. Then we had the art auction the morning. And we had breakfast. And I mean, we dawdled around. And then Archer started the auction from this one to that one. And when he put up the Big Ben painting, I looked at my watch. It was 11:15. Now you see, you exercise your spiritual senses by saying, that's a sign. That's a sign. So I stopped the auction. I said, everyone, look at your watches. Who was there? Neil was there. Look at your watches. 11:15. What's the time on the painting? 11:15. At that moment, that means God is saying something. Now, what is God saying? You've got to exercise your spiritual senses. What is God saying? Well, he's saying that I'm happy with what you're doing. To sell these paintings for missionary work, go ahead. I'm with you. I'll help you. It's what I told you to do. I saw in a dream how I sold watercolor paintings, and they all sold out. But for many years, I didn't have the guts to do it, so I spoke. After many years, told Nola and Aja, and they said, let's do it. And that's how we've helped to sponsor some towards some of the missionary work that we've done in the last few years through the art. So God is saying, there's a sign. You're doing the right thing. He gives signs, but you need spiritual understanding to get that. Anna says, ma, hi, is it not toevallig nie, ne? That's the dumb and dumber version of spiritual signs. You know, to understand what God is saying to you, you need to exercise. But then you can see it all day, every day. You can pick it up. There's a reason why you're here tonight. There's, you know, and to understand that, it's not by accident. It's because God is saying something to you tonight. What is he saying? That's your take-home pay. What is he saying to you? Not all the words I've spoken. Okay? So, exercise your senses. And that's how God also satisfies your soul. Okay, let's try and finish here because I've preached long already and you've listened long already and you probably want to go home by now. So I'll just finish off very quickly. Okay. In your labor for God, in to satisfaction in what you do for Christ, your involvement, try to stay in harmony with others. It's not easy because people are people. But try and stay in harmony instead of discord. That's a bit of wisdom there. And then develop your gifts and talents and teach others to do what you're doing. And God will give you recognition at the right time. We all want recognition, but God gives it in due time. Stay up to date with what's happening. Learn to report back. And if you're in a leadership position, give feedback. Learn to listen. Become flexible, supportive. Try to understand human behavior and get a better knowledge, working knowledge of God. And you can put those two together to serve God and humanity. Have faith in God's ability and the ability has given you so that you can participate. Continually try to improve who you are and what you do. Appreciate the small things God does for you so that you'll have appreciation when he does big things. And give praise where praise is due, not flattery. Flattery is empty. It's flattery is praise given in order to get something from someone. It's gain. Flattery is terrible. It's empty. But we give praise where praise is due. Give thanks where thanks is due. Give honor where honor is due. It will satisfy your soul to do that. Amen? So Christ has created a body for us of believers, given us a mission, given us motivation. And as we get involved in that and see the vision and realize our part in it, it satisfies your soul. He can do it individually as well. As a person, your relationship with him will satisfy your soul. You can go read all those verses we mentioned. But I'm giving you some practical tips on how to live a satisfied life in Christ. It's in spite of the persecution and hardships and things you go through.
See? And then as we worship together like tonight, it's glorious. It's wonderful. Jesus told that woman at the well. He also had a word of knowledge about her and her husband's. And he said to her, you know, God is seeking those who will worship him in spirit and truth. Like we did tonight. We sing the truth and we also sing by the Spirit, new songs, what have you. So we try to do that and God's pleased with that. It satisfies him. And while we're doing what satisfies him, you know what? The bounce back, he satisfies your soul. There's nothing that can satisfy like the Lord. Nothing. Dr. Gray used to say, he loved Milo. And he says, while you're drinking Milo in winter, it's so nice. You hold the warm cup and you sip and taste and, and may it never end. And he says, 5 minutes later, you forgot what it tastes like. It can't satisfy. It's satisfied while you're drinking it. Then it's gone. But Jesus satisfies continually. He compared it like that. Whenever I drink Milo, I think of Dr. Gray. I think, yeah, it's lekker, but it's better to serve Christ. Do something to please him. Do something to finish his work. And you know what? That's what sustained Nola and I through all the years. Doing his work. Doing his will. It sustains you. It carries you through. It builds you up better than any food you can eat. Yes, you know, find out what food is good for you and stick to that. But you know what? Doing his will and finishing his work has more sustaining power than anything you can buy at health shops or whatever. Amen? He satisfies your soul. Satisfies your soul. Your soul is hard to satisfy because human beings are never satisfied. You get a raise at work, you've already spent it in your mind before you get it. You know what you're going to spend it on. So the moment you get the raise, it's already gone. You're never happy. The human being is never happy. He always wants more. It's very difficult to satisfy somebody's soul. We can't do it. It's very hard to please two people at the same time. Someone likes the worship loud. They like loud music. Other one walks out of the church. It's too loud. To get the balance, it's not easy. Why? Everyone's tastes different. Nowadays, when you cook for a family, you've got to cook four different meals because they all have different diets. They eat this and the one eat that, and you've got to cook four times. Nobody eats what's there anymore. I don't eat this, I don't eat that, I need to eat this because my coach says I must eat that, and it's very difficult to please. But when you do God's will and do his work, you please him, and the kickback is your soul will be satisfied. There's a trick there. Amen. Do what he wants, and you'll be satisfied. Don't do what you think, because then you won't be satisfied. Do what he thinks. There's the secret. Amen. Jesus says, I do my Father's will, the one who sent me, and I finish his work, and that sustains me. Incredible power in that verse. Sustaining power that can carry you through life. Give you strength and energy and motivation. One verse. One verse. Tremendous power. Makes you get up in the morning. Give you purpose in life. Amen? Praise God. Let's stand. We pray together. Father, we thank you for your word. Thank you for your church. Thank you for your spirit. We thank you, Lord, that We're learning to do your will and finish your work, and it will sustain us, spirit, soul, and body. We give you glory for that. Everyone say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. All right, if you need prayer, come to the front. We'll pray with you, the rest of you. God bless you. Do you know about how we must pack things tonight? We can put everything in there. Everything must go on that side. They want to clean the floor, stage. So everything must go. So if you can lend a hand, please, we thank you. Put it in there, and God bless you this week. Have a wonderful week. Grace and peace to you.